Good morning. We are doing Uddhava Gita, the last message of Sri Krishna. We had done till verse 13 in the chapter 1. So we will continue from verse 14 onwards. Uddhava Gita, chapter 1, verse 14. May thy feet contribute to our welfare. Thou art the supreme being. Thou art time beyond Prakriti and Purusha, under whose sway are Brahma and all other embodied beings, who fight mutually like unto bullocks with strings passing through their noses. So, we are continuing with the address to Sri Krishna, the gods, goddesses who have come down, and Uddhava himself is addressing Krishna. And here, what are they saying? They are saying that he is the supreme being. That means in everything he is the number one, the ultimate, the everything of everything. Right? And the first word which they use for him over here is, you are time. Now, I want you to think about time. When you think of time, time is going in a linear fashion for you. How does it travel? Suppose it is 6:20, 6:21, 6:22, 6:23, 6:20, like that. It is going ahead. What is past is minus. This is plus. So suppose the time just now is 6:32. Can you go back to 6 o'clock? It's not possible. But science, and in those who write science fiction, they have been trying to tell us about time travel. You have seen a lot of movies, Back to the Future, so on and so forth, lot of movies, where they talk of how you can travel in time, go back, then come back to the future, right? Is it possible theoretically, or is it practically, can you do it? That is the question which everybody wants to find an answer to, isn't it? We all want to find an answer, whether you can practically do that. Human beings find it difficult to travel in time. Spiritual beings, they can travel in time. One of the siddhis means powers, that a person gains when they are on the path of spiritual, when they are doing the pranayama, yogasana and meditation, people get siddhis. One of the siddhis is time travel also. So you can travel in time back and forth, whichever way you want. Then you really wonder, oh, these powers are only there for these babajis and gurus, not for me. I would like to travel in time and I want to change a lot of stuff from back. And I want to change my future also. You cannot interfere with time. Alright? It's rather, you cannot change the past or change the future if you are a normal human being. But can you change the future if you are a spiritual person? Supposed to be feasible, but I wouldn't dare say that it can be done. It is, let us leave it at that. So time. Why is time adhin? You know, to Sri Krishna. What is time? And why is it considered that time is also him? So let us look at it from the point of human beings, spiritual beings, Sri Krishna, three people. Can human beings change time? No. Straight away, no. Can gods change time? Spiritual, you know, all the gods and goddesses and Swamijis and all those people. Realized beings, can they change time? No. Not much. It is not possible. You can say certain things, but I wouldn't. Can Krishna do that? Of course, he is time, so he can do whatever he wants to. He owns the Rolex. Okay, so the idea is, how can he change time? I want you to think time as linear. You're going in a straight line. Straight line. Now let us take a sphere. You know, a sphere. This earth is a sphere. Round ball. Imagine Krishna is at the center of the round ball. And on the periphery, on the surface is time. Let us think like that. So if I draw a circle, okay, just for understanding, if the time is represented on the circle and on the top as say 2nd century, over here as the 10th century, somewhere down below it is written is the 20th century, 20th, 21st century, and here it is BC. We are traveling on the surface. He is in the center. See, from center he can just draw a line and go to this point. Same time he can draw a line and go to this point. He can go here. He can go here. He can come here. Whichever direction he can take, because he is time incarnate. So is it possible for him to be any given place at any point in time? Of course. But we cannot be. This factor called time is him alone. So I will explain how he is time and he is Purusha, Prakriti and all other things put together. Alright? Why? Beginning happened with him only. If beginning happens with him, end happens with him, everything happens inside of him. Inside of him, then everything is him alone, isn't it? An example would be, suppose I take a small particle of you inside your body. Let me take a small dot, maybe a blood vessel, a blood, or maybe a muscle tissue inside of you. You know, you are made up of trillions of cells. How many cells are there? Trillions of cells. If you are made up of trillions of cells, when this cell is born and when this cell is alive and when it dies, do you know? It is happening constantly. And you are giving off all those dead cells, new cells are being born, everything is happening. Is it not inside of you? So if I take just the cell itself, is it not you? Even the part of body is you alone. There was one very funny thing, you know, which happened a few days ago. So somebody said, I'm thinking in my mind. Oh, thinking in your mind. Mind is here, huh? Can't be thinking in the mind. And the mind says that you have to eat the ice cream, let us say. Oh, you are not eating the ice cream, the mind wants to eat an ice cream. So mind is different than you. Can you imagine that? Mind is different, you are different, and everything else is different. So who is doing all these things? Not you. If your mind says go and murder someone, are you not going to jail, or the mind is going to jail? Think about it. you are going. So, mind is you. All the bodies is you. The cell is you. The heart is you. The lungs is you. Everything is you. Including the God within is you. You better take, you know, that this is your property. Possess it. It is you alone. Nobody else. That mind which you think is somebody else is not somebody else doing it. You are doing it. You are responsible. You better take the responsibility. Don't say, I did it with my mind. Oh, some mind is not some computer or something like that separate from you. Mind is you. Intellect is you. Everything is you. So if I consider this as an example where you think everything is you, what makes you think that time is different than Krishna? I hope you got the answer. If the cell is different, then you are not the cell, no? Cell is some other creature going crawling inside your body, tick, 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 all over. Right? Nothing like that. The cell is you. And you are a combination of some 12, 18, I think, trillion cells. I heard somebody say that. Okay, if you are a combination of so many cells, how are the cells held up in place? That means it is you only. You are not some Mr. India invisible person. Got it? So, I hope you understood the word. Time is Krishna. Then he says, he is beyond Purusha and Prakriti. Beyond Purusha and Prakriti. What is Purusha and Prakriti? Purusha is the basis on which this whole world has been created. Okay. Now, on this lies the Prakriti. Prakriti is called Mother Nature in other English terms. Prakriti is Mother Nature. Something is holding up Purusha. Something is holding up Prakriti. So they say, under whose sphere Brahma? Now this Brahma written over here is Brahma, Vishnu and Maheshwara. Okay, not the Brahma. Brahma is what we call as Purusha Prakriti upwards. I'm going to explain that a little. So he says you are beyond. Beyond means far beyond. Greater than. More than. More than. So if it is greater than, more than, the 1 rupee has got 100 coins of 1 paisa, isn't it? I mean, nowadays there is no 1 paisa. So, okay, I'll take a 100 rupee note. It can be broken down into 1 rupee coin, 100 coins, isn't it? So can I say that 57th coin is not yours? Can I say something like that? It's also a part of that 100 rupees, isn't it? It's like a big thing. So let us assume some of the money from that 100 rupees, say 50 rupees is Brahma. 50 rupees is, 100 rupees is Brahma. 50 rupees is Purusha and 50 rupees is Prakriti. Can I separate out there? No, it's in that 100 rupee note. I hope you got it. In 100 rupee note, 50 rupees is Purusha, 50 rupees is Prakriti. Part of that 100 only. I cannot separate it out. So, did you get this? Now, all embodied beings are coming under this. Purusha and Prakriti and then all embodied beings. Embodied means somebody who has a body. Alright? Physical senses, so on and so forth. The body. So embodied beings are coming under Purusha and Prakriti. And are they in harmony with each other? I don't think anybody is harmoniously blending with things like that. No, no, no. Everybody has their own mind, no? Everybody is fighting with each other. I mean, it's like having 100 politicians together. Imagine that, 100 politicians coming together of different parties. Okay, it's going to be exactly like that. So whether there is Brahmaji, there is Vishnu, there is Maheshwara, there is Agni Dev, there is Vayu, there is Lakshmi, Saraswati. Yesterday only we were talking about how Lakshmi gets upset. Today we are talking about all the gods put together. Everybody over here. Everybody. Harmonious living is very difficult. Because our ego comes into the play. You think gods don't have egos? They have big egos. Bigger than ours. Okay? So you will find egos are there. So the moment the ego comes into the play, you will say, ah, you cannot do this. This is my department. Think. Right? So, they fight mutually. Like bullocks. Okay. And how are they treated, by the way? They are literally like, have you ever been to a pen or a place like a ranch maybe, you know, or something like that? It's all surrounded and the cattle and everybody is inside and they cannot go outside that ring. Just imagine all these gods, human beings are tied up inside this. They cannot go outside that. Right? It is like you are confined in a place. And then what do you do when you are confined in a place? You are going to revolt, isn't it? You know how the revolt happens? No, no, I want to go there. I want to go there. What do you mean I want to go there? We all want to go some other place. You know the phrase, grass is greener on the other side. The meadow on this side and a meadow on that side, and you will always look at the other side. Oh, the grass is greener on the other side. I want to go there. It's like yesterday I was seeing something, some pictures of Edinburgh and all those places. Okay, Scotland and all those places. Some nice green pictures. And then some video came of Switzerland with that choo-choo train going, you know, small train is going and all greenery all around. I was thinking, oh, this looks so beautiful. You can stay there for 1 day, 2 days, 10 days. After that, you want to run away from there. Huh? As Bidu will tell you, it's all cold over there. One day it is cold, one day it is hot. So what do you want to do? Exactly like that. Someday it is hot, someday it is cold. We don't want to live in our confinement. So exactly like this, you know. We are literally like the buffaloes whose nose are having that, you know, string. Thou art the cause. So now, I hope you understand. We are all buffaloes. How convenient it is for him to say like that, you know. So we have come to the end of the previous verse 14. So now we will go on to verse 15. So Uddhava Gita, verse 15, chapter 1. Thou art the cause of the origin, continuity, and dissolution of the universe. The Vedas call thee the ruler of the undifferentiated, the Jiva, and the Mahat also. Thou also art time with its three names, which we know to be of immense power, which destroys everything. Ah, thou art the supreme being. This is a continuation of the prayer. They are praising the Lord. So everything begins from the origin. Everybody has heard of the Big Bang. I'm not talking about the show. Okay, otherwise you'll say, oh, you're talking about the Big Bang. No, I'm talking about the real theory, scientific theory, Big Bang theory. Alright, everybody has heard of it. And we thought that was the beginning. I don't think that is the beginning. You know the reason? A new theory has come. It's not new, it's actually old, but somebody has again dug it up. Like we dig the skeletons, you know. Somebody has dug up. Okay, he says, before the Big Bang, what was there? So the energies were gathering. Oh, before that the energies were gathering. By the way, where did the energies come from? Maybe they came from some Prakriti. Oh, where did Prakriti come from? Some Purusha. Where did Purusha come from? No idea. Sir, you can keep on going projection backward, 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 backward. Understand? It is like a person was observing through the telescope and he found the stars are changing places. Suddenly what happens is the star is over here and then suddenly, you know, it becomes lighter. I mean, becomes a little dim or something like that. I mean, it is becoming hazy or it, something like that is happening. Something is happening. So the scientists were wondering, why is it happening? So they put up a telescope somewhere in the space and then they found that, no, oh, stars are moving away. They are moving away. That means, so if I do backwards like this, they must have been at a one point somewhere trillions or billions of years ago, don't know, at a point source. It is just theory. Somebody is saying the stars are here now, they are gone here. So if I go backwards, all the stars will meet at a point somewhere. And when they meet at a point, and then something must have exploded, boom, like that. And everything went like, you know, you blow bombs, you know, atom bombs in Diwali. So something like that blew up and okay, all the stars are going up. So, and then something happens and black holes come in and I don't know. All different theories. And why? But what happened before the Big Bang? Nobody knows. What happened during the Big Bang? Nobody knows. What happened before the Big Bang? I mean, I'm putting two befores, okay? Nobody knows. So it is better to leave it at that. So we take the books like this and we say, okay, fine, we will just accept what is written over here. Because, you know, I am not Harry Potter's mother, no? So I don't know. No magic. So, thou art the cause of the origin. So he's the cause, he's not the origin. Origin is also him, by the way. Cause is also him. Continuity and dissolution. So somewhere down the line, everything is going to dissolve. Dissolve means destroy, dissolve, whatever. So people, they come up every few years, somebody comes up with the theory. What is the theory? It's going to be the end of the world. Every few years, there is going to be an end of the world. And we are still continuing, by the way. Somebody will say there is a hole in the sky. Then what happens? Somebody puts a bandage on it. I mean, these environmentalists, they put bandage on it, isn't it? Right? Then they will say climate change. Climate change is constant. I mean, you go backwards in time. There was an ice age then also. We are going towards another ice age. Whether plastics are contributing, you are contributing, the universe is contributing, I don't know. But we are all contributing towards it because we are all moving towards another ice age. It's a good thing for us, you know. Huh? What? We'll meet those elephants. You remember that fellow who runs after that? We'll meet that guy also. Huh? So all those things are going to happen somewhere in the future. But today, if I have that doomsday picture in front of me, I am not going to survive. So better not bother about all that ice age coming and this and that. I have to be good to myself and the world also. That's it. What does spirituality teach us? Teaches us. It just teaches us to be nice. Be kind to everything, including the universe. So we have to be friendly towards everything. So there is a dissolution coming up. The Vedas call thee the ruler of the undifferentiated. What is undifferentiated? See, if you remember, there is fire and there is power to burn. Two things. Fire, power to burn. Sun and the power to illumine. These two things are there. Huh? Water and thirst. It quenches the thirst. A water is cooler. So, we think these two are separate. What is separate? Sun is separate then light. No. It's one and the same. It is combined together. Right? Then we say fire, power to burn. both are same. Fire is there, power to burn is there. Black is there, white is there. Both are complementary to each other, right? Now, it is saying over here, the Lord Krishna is undifferentiated. You cannot take him out as black or white. It's the same. It is the same. And he can be black, he can be white, he can be whatever he wants to. It is. We cannot say to Krishna, no, you can only be this. If he wants to become purple tomorrow, that is his choice, not our choice, no? He has got the power to do whatever he wants to. So he is the undifferentiated. If he wants to become nothing also, that is his choice. He can be nothing also. You see, the Buddhists have a fight with the Hindus saying that Buddha says the right thing and Hindus don't say the right thing. If the Lord is everything, even nothing is him, no? You got it? So there can never be a different. Now, the problem is we take Hinduism and we take Buddhism, but Hinduism is not a religion. It is Sanatan Dharma. And Sanatan Dharma includes everything. Hinduism, Buddhism, Christianity, everything is included. It is like we are human beings. Human beings is one. Then we say Homo erectus. Okay. Homo Americans, or I don't know, Australia, whatever. It doesn't mean that there are some different people. No. It's only one only. Right? So think like that. So there can be no differentiation. It's all one. The Jiva is undifferentiated. The Jiva and the Mahat. Now, the term Mahat over here talks about at the beginning of time, you know, something came out of it. This undifferentiated was there. Undifferentiated cannot be separated. Something came out. What is that something which came out? Something first popped out. The first thing that popped out is supposed to be Brahma. Can be taken as Mahat also. All right. See, the deeper you try to go inside, your brain is going to get toasted very soon. Okay, so the best thing for us to consider one and the same. Okay, everything is Brahma. All right. And if everything is Brahma, from Brahma came what? Purusha Prakriti. Okay. Two separations. So he says, Mahat is also you. Jiva is also you. That creature that you are, living creature that you are, it's also you. So the Lord is everything. So don't say, like I was talking about 5 minutes ago, my mind is separate. No. Mind is you only. Body is you. The breathing fellow is also you. All our juices are you only. Don't say it's separate. All is one only. So like that, he says, everything is one and the same. That is the Lord himself. Thou art time. I just now spent time telling you about time. That is time. Okay. And the three names of time. Okay, what are the three names? See, her differentiation of three names is, there are supposed to be three seasons, three times in, one is daytime, one is dream, you know, waking time, dream, and then sleep. These are also time, isn't it? Part of time. Then if you take three seasons in a year, you will say, no, there are four seasons. Some people will say there are six seasons. Okay, seasons, man, it's one and the same. One is hot on one side, one is cold on the other side. And in between, whatever comes. Right? In between hot and cold, something will come, isn't it? Maybe you will become ice. Okay, maybe it will rain. It's okay. Just say that there are three seasons. All right? Between day and night, there must be something, no? Twilight. Okay. So like that. So the time is divided into three. So, which we know to be of immense power. Of course, it is of immense power. If I divide time into three, when there is summer, you are going to say, oh my God, it's so hot. I'll put on the fan and the AC and everything. And then seasons change, becomes cold. You want to put on the AC and the fan at that time? No, you want to put on the heaters and you want to wear warm clothes. See, it is always like that. Did I not tell you the grass is greener on the other side? When it is cold, you want it to be hot, and when it is hot, you want it to be cold. And then sometimes you say, can I have in between? And that in between is very wet. Then what happens? Well, there is a problem there also. Then you want to wear a raincoat. See, we are not satisfied with what we have. We always want the other side. So here it is like this. The immense power is there. The power of one, another and another. All these put together are different powers. What does it do? It destroys everything. We just started from, you know, the beginning, the middle and the end. The end is always going to be there. To everything there is an end. And thou art the supreme being. So who is the supreme being? Krishna is the supreme being, and he has everything in one, all in one. Okay, so we have come to the end of verse 15. The 15th verse is talking about how it starts, where it is in the middle, where it ends. You are the time. He talks about undifferentiated. What is undifferentiated? Neither this nor that, isn't it? Neither Purusha nor Prakriti, just the Brahma. Brahma also is undifferentiated. Then we were talking about the three parts of time. Then we talked about how these powers are there. All this comprises of the dear Lord, Krishna itself. So we have come to verse 15n. So we are going to do verse 16. Uddhava Gita, chapter 1, verse 16. Receiving energy from thee, the Purusha of infallible power, along with Maya, holds within himself the Mahat, like the embryonic state of the universe. This Mahat, backed by the same Maya, projected from within itself the golden sphere of the universe, provided with its outer covering. I'm not going to take more time on this verse because we have been talking about the same thing continuously. So I'll just give you an understanding. The Lord is primordial. Way before. Too much before. Now and later on also. So, he's there. When he started the whole thing, he started it in the form of Purusha Prakriti, okay? But before that came Brahma, the unmanifest kind of a thing. From the unmanifest came the manifest. Manifest is everything, you, me, the trees, the birds, the bees, everything, everything is manifested. So before it manifested, all that was on the drawing board. You agree with me, everything is on the drawing board. But before the drawing board, what was there? I was thinking about it. Like you also say, I am thinking about it. So God must have been thinking about it. And who is this person who is creating all these beautiful pictures? The person who creates these beautiful pictures is called Maya. You give crayons to 100 children. Okay. And tell them to draw. Okay, I'm giving them paper also. So even if I give paper, there will be some children who will look at the wall behind and they will draw the wall also. You know, there are these kind of children also, no? So some will draw on their hand and somebody's face. You didn't tell them you are supposed to draw on the paper. See, you told them go ahead and draw. So they can draw wherever they want to. So Maya is exactly like that. How does Maya work? Nobody can understand. Okay. His Maya is with the crayons. She's a child with the crayons. She does drawing wherever she feels like. Does it have conformity? Does it have some sense in it?
To you, it has no sense, but to Maya, it has sense. Did you understand? For the child, it has sense. The child will draw something like this, round, 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 and you ask him, what is that? You can't make head nor tail out of it, but the child will say, that is mummy. But it is round, round, round. How can that be mummy? No, I drew you. Do you know this? The child is always like this. For the child's mind, it is mummy. Alright? And they will draw something and that is daddy. And this is house and this is car and this is me. When the child grows slightly older, then at least some face and some features will pop up. Okay, in the painting and the picture. But otherwise, no face, nothing, nothing, nothing. Some round scrawl somewhere and say, that is mummy, this is daddy. This is me. Alright? So, I still carry one small picture in my purse somewhere. A child had drawn something, you know. And said, this is you. I can't make out whether it is me or so what. I kept it because that is how it looks to the child. And child is like Maya. For her, everything is in an art. Maya is an artist. That is why all kinds of things happen to you. You understand? Have you seen all kinds of things happen to you? Why? Because Maya is an artist. Sometimes she'll say, oh, this nose doesn't look nice. Okay, I'll make a pointy nose for you. There you got it. Okay, she does plastic surgery also, by the way. Maya is like that. So Maya is also the Lord. Okay. Why? Because he likes to paint. There was a very funny incident in just a few days ago. All the captains of all the cricket teams were standing with the Queen of England, you know, and they were taking an official picture. You know, there are memes also, M-E-M-E. Okay. Somebody came up with a meme, and behind that, behind the Queen and those 18 guys, okay, there was a very nice picture. Somebody went and put another picture and transformed it. And it was from a film of Anil Kapoor. Okay. Majnu Bhai had drawn that picture. It is about a horse and a donkey. The horse is there and the donkey is there on top. So, can you imagine? It is exactly like that person. Who? Anil Kapoor. His name was Majnu Bhai in that film. And Majnu Bhai's picture. Nobody knows how Majnu Bhai draws. So Majnu Bhai and Maya is something like that. Nobody knows what she draws. Okay? And which color she is going to use and how it's going to use. So that is Maya for you. Very peculiar for us, our small minds to understand. So let us not try to, you know, break our head over Maya. Maya is the power of the Lord. So, along with Maya, holds within himself the Mahat. The Lord holds within himself the Mahat. I told you the primordial substance, the gooey stuff, you know, from what he makes. Okay. Or, you know, the clay. You hear that clay which the children play with, something like that. Like the embryonic state of the universe. Embryonic state. Embryo. Embryo is from where child is born, you know, exactly like that. So from where everything comes out. This Mahat, backed by the same Maya. That is the drawing board. Now again, I am making a mistake calling it a drawing board. Maya can draw anywhere. She's like a kid, I told you, no? She can draw anywhere. She'll draw in space also like this. And tomorrow you'll find some stars standing over there. Okay? She will say, where do I sweep all the kachara that is there? Kachara means all that. You know, when I was making all this Earth and Mars and Venus and all that. Okay, a lot of thing was left behind. And I was making Saturn and Venus, I don't know, beyond that, Jupiter and all. So what do? I sweep it in between and I call it the asteroid belt. You know, the asteroid belt is all the pieces of garbage all over the place. But that garbage is very rich. No, we can't call it garbage. They've got all good minerals and stuff over there. So, you know, Maya is exactly like that. She will say, okay, let me put the garbage bin somewhere in the middle. That is how all that belt came into the picture, no, suddenly. So we don't know how she works. Her mind works in a very unique manner. So Maya is exactly like that. So how did it happen? It came from itself, the golden sphere. I think I have done enough on Anda. You know, the egg, the sphere from which everything comes out. All right. So sphere of the universe provided with outer covering. Outer coverings are what? The outer reaches of the universe also there. We don't know what they are, by the way. Similarly, the outer reach of our earth is what? We are living on it, no? The land on which we are living on. Huh? Outer reach of this earth is also stratosphere, and beyond that is the atmosphere somewhere. So we do not know. So everything has an inside and an outside also, if it is a sphere. Right? Maybe hollow, I don't know. Correct? So, all these put together, combine this entire thing together, is nothing but the power and the energy of the divine, Krishna himself. And there is no differentiation between him and something else. It's like you. You. You are full of that. Don't even say that I don't know. You are having all those powers. The power of imagination is Maya. The power of creation is Maya. You can create objects. You can destroy them also. You are like the kid. You are like that old man also. You are like that wild fellow also. There is no way of conformity. You know? We try to restrain ourselves just like those bull in the bullpen, or the buffaloes, I was talking about them, or the hen and the crow, you know, hen in that coop, exactly like that, we are like that, but we can draw, we can do things. The power is within you, within these confines of your body also. Power is within you, use it, you are a part of that Brahma, you are a part of that divine. So Krishna is like that. Just imagine a gazillion times bigger than us. Huh? Imagine that. No harm in imagining, isn't it? Maya is there. And that is exactly how it is going to be. So don't bother your head about it. You have the power. The Lord has given you the power. Try to use it. So we have come to the end of verse 16. Right? What was this verse 16 about? The verse is talking about Purusha, the infallible power, the Maya, the Mahat. Everything is a part of him alone. How it comes from the embryonic state, how it takes shape, Maya's different moods, how she can draw. This is what everything belongs to Krishna alone. And the gods and everybody is praying to Krishna and saying, you are that as well. So we have just ended verse 16. Next week we will do verse 17 onwards. So we will stop over here. You have a good day.